Okay, so thank you all of you for being here, for attending this tutorial. We are very pleased to collaborate with OpenPOWER and with IBM and deliver this training that we are already delivering in the US, in Saudi Arabia, across Europe. And we have started to do it this year, so we are very happy to engage very fast with OpenPOWER and with IBM to also do it in the scope of this event and OpenPOWER event. We hope that this is the first of a series of training events that we can deliver. So essentially, I guess that the reason why you are here is, do you want to be competitive in your work? Do you want to accelerate the runtime of your applications? Is that the main goal that you have? Because that's usually the reason why people is attending or using parallel computing or parallel programming. In the end is solving the same problem, the same numerical problems, but much faster, or solving bigger problems that you can solve, not sequentially, but exploiting parallelism. So somehow you want to be competitive in your science, in your work, in an industrial environment, whatever you are doing. And as I told you, we have started this year to do similar training events. NERSC in the US, Department of Energy in San Francisco, CAUS, Saudi Arabia, Barcelona Supercomputing Center in Spain, we have been collaborating with them 4 years now. ISC, the second, there are two major conferences worldwide in supercomputing. Supercomputing in the US next month, but usually in June, you also have the biggest event in Europe that is called ISC. And for the first time, we also did this similar training in ISC. So essentially, we have assumed, as I more or less sampled yesterday by raising questions to the air, if any of you have already experienced with GPU programming or not. Some people already had some experience, others was the first time that they tried to develop code for GPUs. Some of you also didn't even develop parallel code before this event. So whatever the previous background is, the course is designed so that you can understand the basics of what you have to do, what are the major challenges that you need to address to go from sequential code to parallel code, independently if you go to multi-core CPU or if you have a OpenPOWER GPU system and you want to use the GPUs. There are several key concepts that you need to learn no matter where you implement and where you run your parallel code, okay? So essentially, this is the split that we are doing in our approach for training. We clearly split the analysis part, so understanding your source code, not your algorithm. We don't want to change or engineer your algorithm. You have an algorithm that you have coded in a computer program, and that's the code that you need to modify to introduce parallel semantics to run it faster on a parallel computer. So one of the major challenges that you will be addressing is analyzing your code, understanding your code in depth. This is usually something that we try to do faster than is really needed. And in the end, if you don't do it precisely enough, you will be implementing parallel code, you will be overseeing some characteristics or features in your code that when you go implement parallel code, the code will be incorrect. Will run faster, but will be incorrect, and that is useless, completely useless, okay? So you need to, we need as computer scientists to somehow change our mindset and focus on doing a good analysis, especially when you're going to go to execute parallel code. And the second part is, once you understand your code, once you understand what it is doing and how to parallelize it, you need to design how you're going to parallelize it. You need to choose the API you're going to use, MPI, OpenMP, OpenACC, POSIX threads, OpenCL, CUDA. There are many, many possibilities. But there are possibilities that you need to consider in the implementation stage, once you know how your code behaves and how to parallelize it. So this is what we call the design space of parallel programming, and you need to decide how or where you want to implement the parallel version targeting a given hardware system that you want to use, okay? So essentially, this is what we will cover in this course. The first part is analysis of the source code to decide how to parallelize it. We will not be talking about parallel implementation itself in that stage. So essentially, we will provide you with, we'll describe you the steps that you have to do, kind of a methodological framework, what you need to do step by step to go from sequential to parallel code. And instead of doing it in the classical approach that you will find in the, all of the rest of trainings, except the training we have been starting to do this year. They usually do it analyzing in very, very much detail each instruction of your code, how each instruction interacts with other instructions when they are executed in parallel, and how the memory is used in the, in the concurrent execution of these instructions. But this is, for simple pieces of code, is something you can do. 3 lines of code, 100 lines of code, but imagine millions of lines of code of production code, and you want to port it, you want to parallelize it. Using this low-level approach will be very error-prone and very, very time-consuming. So we want to raise the level of abstraction of that, so that in terms, instead of reasoning at the level of the statements of your code, can we reason at the level of what we call code patterns? Can we decompose the application in code patterns? That, of course, in the end, a given code pattern can be implemented with one instruction or with 1 million of instructions. But the pattern will tell you the essential features that you need to know about your code to decide how to parallelize it and how to implement it in parallel. Okay? So this code pattern is the key concept that we introduce in the trainings, in our tools, that is not used in any other, we have not found any other training or tools that use this kind of approach. So we will start focusing on what we call computation patterns. Computation patterns essentially are the hotspots. When you run your code, there is usually 1, 2, 3 functions that consume up to 90% of the runtime. So let's start working with that, because if we can divide by 2 the runtime of that part, it will have a strong impact on the runtime of the whole application. Okay? So this is what everybody calls hotspots. And what we do is we will tell you, we will show you how to understand how to parallelize the hotspots using a type of code patterns that we call computation patterns. We will go into some detail on this during this morning. Okay? And in the end, this will enable to what? Instead of being able to parallelize simple codes that are useful for labs, you will be able to decompose real applications in patterns and reason about the parallelization in patterns. So for that, we will show you, we will present you two example codes to work on the hands-on session after the break. One very simple code that I will be using in my demonstrations, the typical computation of Pi, 5 lines of code, because if it's the first time, it's enough to play with all of these concepts and really understand the approach. But if, for those of you that already have some experience, we propose you to play with this LulishMK. LulishMK is a simplification that we have created of the real Lulish code of the Coral Benchmarks of the Department of Energy. So it is real code of Lulish, but we have pruned some functions just to make it, just to limit the complexity to something that can be addressed in a training of half a day or 1 day. Okay? So depending on your background, we also have more examples in the tool, HIT, Laplace, matrix multiplication. We have plenty of them. So, but we will provide you with, present these two examples. And then you will also learn how to implement it. This is, in the end, what you want to do. And we are supporting implementation for CPU and GPU using OpenMP and OpenACC compiler directives. Okay? And all of this is supported by the tool. Some parts are automated. Other parts will require that you provide some additional hints to the tool so that you can finally make a parallel implementation using the tool. Okay? This will enable you to what? Given the same code, Pi, given the same, once you know what it is doing, you will be able to generate up to 10, 12 different versions of Pi. That would be very time consuming. You have to write it separately, test them, and debug it. So the tool will help you to quickly explore different implementations that you can, within the tool, compile and run in different programming environments. Okay? And you will, of course, learn the commonalities of what can you use independently if you are going to the GPU or if you are going to the CPU. So essentially, this is what makes our training completely different to the other trainings that you will find out there. And here we have presented, to keep it short enough for this 1 day or half day tutorial, we will focus on this. And of course, we have more intermediate level courses, more advanced courses, more types of patterns, computation, memory, flow patterns that provide you a better, even better understanding of the code. But we have removed this from the course today because it is too much to be addressed in just 3 hours. We want to give you the minimum concepts that are needed so you can have 4 outcomes really clear and you can really, based on that, build more complicated learning for parallel programming. So what we are doing, Javier will be helping me, you already know him, with installation issues, uses of the tool, while I'm explaining more the key concepts, but both of us can explain you the key concepts behind the approach and behind the tool. So two lectures this morning, you can see them, we have tried to keep them as short as possible. First, let's introduce OpenMP and OpenACC briefly, and let's introduce CPU and GPUs briefly. We will not go into the hardware details. We will just highlight the minimum you need to know what's the difference between both of them that have an impact in the way you need to program them, okay? CPUs and GPUs are very, very complicated at the low level. We don't need to know all of that. We just need to know the key hardware features that are relevant for the programming point of view. And then we will see some of the patterns, because we need to introduce at least the compute patterns that you will need for the practicals, okay? Then we will do the break, and after that we have hands-on with these two examples. And finally, we have reserved 10 to 15 minutes to close the session so that we can wrap up and discuss final conclusions, and we can give you more information about later steps or other options that you have after this course, okay? So you already have all the materials on the website. I understand that you have the tool installed, you have downloaded the materials, so you have all of that. We will also provide you a worksheet in paper to facilitate the hands-on session if you decide to do any of these two examples. And of course, it is key for us to improve this training. We will provide you also a survey that we will ask you to please fill in and give it to us in hand, so that we can really improve this training for future editions, okay? Okay, so I understand that here there should be no more important questions, so let's go into the... Okay, let's go into the first lecture. So the idea here is to let you know what OpenMP is, what OpenACC is, differences from the point of view of using them to program to code parallel code, parallel software, and CPUs and GPUs, and only the key difference that you need to know to get started, especially with the GPU. Okay, so let's start. 4 points we would like to highlight. Typically, you will see pictures of a host or a CPU with a small number of boxes, and a GPU or an accelerator or a device with many, many, many boxes. So what is this trying to highlight? First, number of cores available in the hardware. On multi-cores, CPUs, typically you can run up to 4, 8, 24 cores. If you use the power system, you can run up to 160 cores on a multi-core CPU, okay? But this is very slow, very small, compared with the number of cores that you have on the GPU. Imagine that in the GPU you will have thousands of cores that you can use at the same time. So we're talking 110 or 100 in contrast to 1,000, 2,000, thousands of cores that you have available, okay? So this is why these GPUs are said to be a beast from the computational power point of view, because you have thousands of threads available for you. First difference. Second difference, grouping of threads at the hardware level. For those of you that have programmed multi-core CPUs, you usually OpenMP or POSIX thread. Who has experience with OpenMP? All of you, perfect. You create the parallel region, you destroy the parallel region, you share the workload with the four, you control it with a schedule, and you don't worry about anything else. The threads are created, and every single thread can communicate or share information with any other thread, okay? In the GPU level, this doesn't work like that. In the GPU level, you create thousands of threads, but in the hardware automatically groups the, let's say, to say one number, 1,000 threads creates groups of 64 threads that are executed all together. And the threads within this group can communicate to each other, but cannot communicate directly with threads in a different group. Okay? And this happens transparently to us in the hardware. So we need to be aware of that, because somehow it makes the programming model a bit more complicated, because we cannot share information between any two arbitrary pair of threads on the GPU. Okay? So this is this point, second point. Point number three, the complexity of the memory design. Those of you that have coded OpenMP, who has coded with the cache, exploiting locality in the cache? Blocking, tiling, what kind of transformation? Depends, exactly. Have you done it? No, great. Then in the CPU, from the memory perspective, from your perspective, the memory is one block of memory locations that you can use. But if you want to further optimize the performance of your code, then you need to be aware of the memory that is a bit more complex. You have the main memory, but in the middle between the processor and the memory, you have a cache. If you write your code so that you are aware of the cache, you can speed up the acceleration of your sequential code and of your parallel code several orders of magnitude, if you do it really, really well. But it is very hard to code, very error prone, and there are some parameters that are hardware dependent. So somehow if you do it, optimize it very, very much, you are making your code somehow dependent on the hardware, of the size of the cache line, the associativity, all of these features of the cache, okay? So usually when you program for the CPU, you don't go down to that level. On the GPU, this is way more complicated. We also have a global memory that is more or less like our main memory of the CPU. But between the memory and the registers of the CPU, you have in the middle several memories. The scratch pad, the texture memory, the cache, the shared memory that is shared among the threads in the same group. And the usage of those memories are faster than the main memory, as the cache is faster than the main memory. But if you want to code using these memories, again, the code begins to be very, very complicated, okay? But there are some things of this complex memory design that are visible in the programming model of the GPU, okay? So we need to be aware of that. In the CPU, we can program only abstracting away the level of the cache. And we can program, we can do it. On the GPU, you cannot do it. At some point, you need to take into account at least some information between the threads that can communicate through what memory they can communicate, okay? So you need to have into account also point number three. And point number four, execution of instructions in vector mode. Who has vectorized or synthesized code? Using pragmas, using intrinsics, okay. You have not done that? Okay, so again, on the CPU, you can program as you have done it. You can optimize your code exploiting different lower levels of the memory, but there is a part of the instructions of the processor that you are not using. You have bought a processor that has scalar instructions and vector instructions. You are not using part of the capability that you have purchased and you have paid for by buying that processor, okay? So when you want to code with cache in mind and also with vectorization in mind, the code begins to be very, very complicated to debug and to write, okay? But again, you do that because you really need peak performance on that hardware architecture. So on the GPU, there is something similar in the sense that we have thousands of threads that are grouped, and within each group, there are subgroups that are called warps. So each warp is somehow, you can see it as a different flavor of a vector or a SIMD instruction, so that all of the threads running in the same work are executing at the same time, the same operation in the same cycle. So if you are able to exploit that, you are further accelerating your code for the GPU, okay? It's a bit more complicated than that, but fortunately we have compiler support in OpenMP and OpenACC that are able to do the hard work for us if we add the appropriate pragmas and clauses in the programming environment, in the programming model, okay? So just consider that you have all of these differences, and many of them are optional. You can use it or not on the CPU. They are not optional on the GPU. You will need to manage them up to some point, okay? Somehow. Okay, so let's go on. This is changing, but essentially this is the main setup of a GPU or accelerated machine. You have your CPU that accesses your memory, and somehow you have to transfer information from the memory of the CPU that the CPU can access to the memory that the GPU or the device can access. And you cannot make typically this cross access. So you need, you have a botnet that is executing here on the host, using the host memory, and whenever there is something you want to offload to the accelerator, offload to the device, you need to specifically transfer, copy the data to the device, launch the kernel on the GPU so that it uses that data, and the results need to be transferred back to the host memory that can print out the results on the console or on the, to the, for the user, the result of your application, okay? So this is what is called, is the typical GPU accelerator model, and is the model that we, that you have in these power systems. Or even in your laptops, you usually, they usually come already now with GPUs, so if you do the proper settings of your software stack, you can use this kind of executor model even on your laptops, okay? So this is what is called a host-driven execution model. What this means is that, as in OpenMP, you compile and you launch your application, one single thread starts the execution. When the parallel region is reached, several threads are spawned or created, they collaborate, and in the end of the parallel region, they are destroyed, only one survives, and continue execution, okay? So, similar model we have it for the GPU. You start one thread, and whenever you reach a parallel region for the GPU, thousands of threads are created, but instead of being executed on the host, on the CPU, all the information, all the computation are transferred, offloaded to the device, it is done there, and the results are transferred back to the CPU, to the CPU memory. And again, all of them are destroyed, and only one survives and continue execution, okay? So from this perspective, both models are similar, okay? Okay, this is already done. So here, when does it good for a code to be to run faster, to offload computations to the GPU, or to use the multiple threads of the CPU? It depends on the computational load of the of the code that you want to parallelize. Having said that, on the CPU, if you have one code with only 10 iterations, very simple iterations, executing this in parallel usually is slower than executing sequentially, because you need to, all the overhead of creating the threads, sharing the workload, executing, destroying the threads, is takes more time than just running the four iterations sequentially, okay? So on the GPU, we have more parallelization overhead. We need to spawn not four, thousands of threads. We need to transfer data from the CPU to the GPU memory. The memory is not, the threads cannot access to the CPU memory. And the results need to be transferred back. So even if the execution model is similar, there behind the scenes, we need to do many more things for the model to run and give us a consistent result, okay? So this is what is typically called parallelization overhead. So the parallelization overhead for the GPU is much higher than the parallelization overhead for the multi-core CPU. So for your code to run faster, you need to have pieces of code, hotspots that are very computationally intensive, take really, really a long time to execute. And that way, this parallelization overhead will be amortized and will not have an impact in the final timing, runtime of your code, okay? So this is what we need to do, and this is why we focus on the hotspots of your code to begin to work when we want to flow to the GPU, okay? Questions? Both things, the number of iterations that you have and the number of operations that you have in each iteration. The multiplication of both, roughly, gives you an estimation of the workload, the amount of work that you have to do to complete that loop, okay? So overall, this estimation needs to be high enough so that this all of this parallelization overhead can be amortized. And finally, your code runs faster. That is your final objective, right? Good. Okay, so essentially this is what we say when we want to go to the GPU. We need to transfer data to the device, get the results from the device, give to the device enough work to do, focus on the hotspots, on the loops that are really computationally intensive, and try to reuse the data on the device instead of transfer back and forth, back and forth, back and forth data from the CPU memory to the GPU memory. And with these three rules in mind, we will learn how to implement them in OpenMP and OpenACC pragmas and clauses to really have minimized this parallelization overhead. So the same model that applies for CPU applies for GPU in the sense that this is host-driven. One single thread starts, one single thread ends, and in each parallel region, tens or thousands of threads are created, and all the additional operations are done to transfer data to the GPU if needed, to transfer the results from the GPU if needed. Okay? But from our understanding, from an abstract point of view, this is essentially the execution model that we have with OpenMP and OpenACC for CPU and GPU. So why using OpenMP and OpenACC? Okay, GPUs have a reputation for being difficult to use because of programming, and they really are. If you code at the CUDA level, at the low level, as if in the CPU, as if you code using the instruction set architecture of the vector operations, using the cache, it is complicated. And your code gets easily unrecognizable with respect to the code you started to work with, okay? So OpenMP and OpenACC are an attempt, try to change that, so that somehow you just need to, you keep the same piece of code, and you just need to add additional semantics, and you have the support of the compiler that does all the necessary transformations to transform the sequential code into an optimized parallel version, okay? So instead of coding by hand, we have the support of the compiler for OpenMP and OpenACC. OpenMP and OpenACC, as a consequence, improve portability and readability of the code. If you have the cache in mind, if you have look at CUDA code, essentially it is doing the same. But understanding the code is very time-consuming, very difficult many times, and the code is not portable in the sense that if you go to a different architecture, maybe there are parameters in the code that are dependent on a given GPU model, or you cannot go from a GPU of one vendor to a GPU of a different vendor, okay? Or to a given accelerator device. So OpenMP, OpenACC provide us, aim to provide us portability and improved readability. This is also where we started some minutes ago. You don't need to fully understand all the complexity of the hardware level. As you don't need to understand the complexity of the cache or of the vector instructions on the CPU, you need to understand all the complexity of the execution model internally on the GPU hardware. Only those things that are exposed in the... Please, go ahead. This minimizes the need for code refactoring. If you compare a SIMD version for the CPU with our sequential code, the code has been completely refactored many times. And the standard support C, C++, and Fortran, which are the three typical programming languages that are used in HPC and in parallel code. At this moment, all the examples that we have are in C, and we are moving fast into Fortran codes. We will present some news in a few weeks in supercomputing in the US, and also C++ recognizing C code inside C++ projects. That's the directions where we are, where we want to go, and where we are moving. Okay, so to summarize, OpenMP and OpenACC are essentially a method to use open multi-core CPUs and GPUs for C, C++, and Fortran. They provide directives that somehow we specify what we want to do and how we want to do it. We don't get our hands dirty because it is the compiler that does the rewriting, the refactoring of the code according to the specification we have given through the pragmas and the clauses. Okay? And also provide some runtime libraries and environment variables to control the number of threads at runtime and any other things that you can control on your code. And both tools provide the same. And both of them support the host accelerator programming model, the one we said. Everything starts on the CPU and the parallel region. It is executed in parallel or offloaded to the GPU. When everything ends, only one thread survives and continues the execution. Okay? And this is very important. Both are focused on portability and readability of the code. Okay, so this is more or less an almost up-to-date how the market is in terms of compilers supporting OpenMP and OpenACC and different versions of the standard. OpenMP is now in version 5. The specification was released 1 year ago, but compilers are not still mature to use the main new features of OpenMP 5. So essentially, all of them are supporting up to OpenMP 4.5. This is the highest standard version that we are also supporting in our tools. And for OpenACC, we have essentially OpenMP 2.5 or above, except for the gray environment that has fall behind, and Intel and client that don't support OpenACC at this moment, as far as we know. Okay. Okay. So as you are familiar, all of you are familiar with. Have you coded in OpenMP?
Yes.
Yes. Okay. Perfect. So all of us are familiar with the syntax. So I can skip this slide. I will just introduce. The standards are growing to be quite big, but I will show. We will focus only on the key pragmas and clauses we need to learn. Parallel, to specify where the parallel execution begins and where it ends. Okay, you are both familiar. All of you are familiar with it. In OpenACC, it's very similar. Instead of using this sentinel, we use the sentinel of OpenACC, and we compile with OpenACC support enabled. Loop for odo. These are essentially three directories, three keywords, to specify how the iterations of a loop are distributed or assigned to the threads that are created. Okay, the same concept that you are using in the CPU, you have the same for the GPU. OpenACC parallel replicates the code. With loop, it creates the threads and also distributes the iterations between the threads. Okay, so essentially the same key concepts at this level. Atomic. There are codes that are fully parallel. We will see them. So you can just create parallel for parallel loop, run in parallel, and everything works just fine. But the reality is that, in general, big applications don't run correctly if you don't add additional synchronization. So the most basic way that you need to synchronize is whenever there are two iterations that can write, read and write on the same memory location, a potential risk condition, you need to specify and protect that access so that you cannot have both two threads running at the same time, modifying the same location, because the result will be unpredictable from the numerical point of view. Okay, so atomic, there are many other ways of protecting or adding synchronization, but atomic is key from the point of view that it is more basic, the more easy to understand. And target and data, and data and target data. Remember that in contrast to the CPU, in the GPU we have two separate memories. So we need to specify what data, what arrays, what values are copied to the GPU memory before launching the execution on the GPU and transfer this information back. How do we do this? We have an additional directive that is data in OpenACC or target data in OpenMP. Okay? We are also supporting this in the tool, so you will be able to learn all of these features by example, analyzing the examples that we will be using today in the practicals. Right? And finally, for those of you that are interested, essentially, in OpenMP, we have four parallel programming paradigms. Multithreading, classical OpenMP, distributing iterations to different threads, running at the same level. Offloading, doing that, but offloading computation and data to the GPU. We have talked about synthesization or vectorization. It's a different way of doing exploiting parallelism in modern hardware architectures. And tasking. Tasking is, who is familiar with tasking? One, two out of four? Okay. Tasking essentially is, when you use the other approaches, essentially, you are specifying in your program how the iterations are mapped to the threads. This is not exactly precise, but it's just I want to remark the difference between the motivation for the tasking paradigm in contrast to the other paradigms. In tasking, imagine that there are many applications that are so irregular that you cannot predict how many tasks you will have. You cannot predict the duration of each task, how many iterations each task will be running, what control flow will be following in the if in the procedure calls. So in many, there are codes where they have a very irregular nature, in the sense that every single run can span many different threads with very different workloads, with very different iterations. So whenever you cannot control that in your program, you can delegate that to a runtime. Sorry, you can delegate that to a runtime. So this is essentially where tasking comes into play. What you do is, you just, within a parallel region, you just specify pragmas that create tasks. tasks that can correspond to whole loops, to loop iterations, to a subset of loop iterations. You decide the granularity of each task, what parts of the computations are assigned. So during the execution, what this code is doing is just creating tasks, task, 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 task. And there is a runtime with a pool of tasks that dispatches these tasks to the cores that are available for execution of new tasks. Everything at runtime completely adapted and dynamically to the different workloads of your code. Okay? So tasking is one of the more promising programming paradigms for exascale systems. Why? Because they are so complicated. Imagine a machine where you have two power systems connected with four GPUs, with other FPGAs, and with accelerator or ASICs devices. Mapping everything statically may be really, really complicated. So one way of approaching this complexity is just creating tasks that span correctly with the proper synchronization and have a runtime that is able to just create tasks, dispatch tasks, and when one is completed, notify it is completed and dispatch a different task to the available resources. Okay? So the runtime manages everything at runtime and can adapt to the hardware available and also to the features of the applications. Okay? So this is an emerging paradigm. And we are also supporting tasking in OpenMP version 3 and OpenMP version 4.5 in the tool, in Parallelware Training. So you can play with it and learn also from it this promising tasking paradigm. Okay, if you have doubts and you are curious about this, do not hesitate to ask us during the practicals. Okay, so what I will do now is I will open the Parallelware Trainer tool. Some of you have already been playing with the tool yesterday, but I want to show you how to use it. Very, very simple walkthrough, the main features of the tool. So let me sit down. Okay, so essentially what we have here, this is the UI. Essentially, what we have here is, looks like an ID. So project manager, we can handle different projects at the same time. You open a project is essentially a directory where you have your code, okay? Once you open a project, you can double click on the files and the files are opened. What this means is that you can have syntax highlighting and the typical capabilities of every single of any other editor. What do you have new from with respect to other editors? You have these green circles here. These green circles here mean that the Parallelware technology has analyzed the source code, has made data dependence, data flow analysis, has analyzed all the features of your code, and is pointing you that loop, is saying that loop, taking into account because you can parallelize it. You can convert it into parallel code. So if you remember, we want to tackle two of the most time-consuming parts of the parallelization process, analysis of the application. If you need to do that by hand, you need to understand every single instruction, every single iteration, every single memory location, how it is read and write to find potential race conditions and generate parallel code. The tool with the green circles is doing that for you, okay? And if you want to run the code, I will not do it here for because of I don't want to spend time in that, but you have this setup dialog where you can put the typical build command, GCC, whatever, a make file, a script file, in the same way as you code, as you compile, you build your application in the terminal of your Linux or Windows system, you just have to type that command here, okay? And to run, again, the same command that you would execute if you were executing on the terminal, okay? So from that point of view, the UI is just a kind of a front-end that takes the commands and launches the commands in the scope of a terminal environment that is created in every single run. Nothing new compared to the way that other IDEs or editors work, okay? So let's focus on the key different features. If you click on this opportunity, you are presented with this dialogue. What this dialogue is the green circle is solving, helping you to solve the analysis part. Now we need to help you in the design space of choosing what parallel, how you want to implement your code in parallel and actually implement it before running it and doing the benchmarking to select the fastest version, So here what you can do is you can choose between OpenMP, OpenACC, CPU, GPU, three programming paradigms, not yet vectorizations in the session that will come at some point. And then we have other ways of controlling different ways of generating parallel code. Okay? You will play with that during the practical. So let me just show you how to go generate parallel code using OpenMP for multithreading for the CPU. Just click on parallelize, and here is your parallel code. So now you can begin to analyze and learn, by example, where the parallel region begins and ends, the distribution, the share, the data scoping of all the variables, if they are shared, private, or they need to be reduced in order to compute the reduction and the global sum of this iteration. So all of this analysis is done for you, and the tool is able to build the parallelization strategy and implement it for you. Right? So you will be able, you will want to compile it and run it, see the performance, and you will probably want to also generate different versions. So you can save this version. This, I like this version, so let's call it PI1. Okay, this version appears here, so that at any time I can take this version and restore it in the main editor. So we have a built-in capability to version, so that you can have different parallel implementations of the same file and play with them. Okay, so I will now restore the original version. Just take original. With this button, I will restore it. So now I have the original code with a nice green circle here. Let's generate another version, for instance, with OpenACC for GPU for offloading, and click on parallelize. And now I have an OpenACC version that runs faster and is correct. Okay? We can save this version, but I will skip that. I will restore the original. You can do it later. And just show you, for instance, how to do it with OpenMP for GPUs and with tasking, very, very fast. OpenMP for GPU, offloading, parallelize, and here you have the target map to control data transfers back and forth. You have the, your parallel region, you have your work sharing with the reduction protection. Okay? And finally, I just want to show that in just a few minutes, if the code is understood correctly, then the tool that the technology enables to quickly explore different parallel implementations that are correct, so you can run it on different systems and pick up the fastest one. Okay? Just because it is new, the tasking part with, is only supported in OpenMP with OpenMP 3.5 parallelized, and here you have your tasking implementation that just spawns one task for every single iteration of the loop. So you can learn all the capabilities that you have in the standards. Okay? Okay, and essentially you can build and run just clicking on these buttons, and here you have the console of the build, the console of the execution, and also the console of parallelware. Parallelware is telling you what it has found. It says, I have found something that is called a scalar reduction pattern. Now in the second lecture, we will go into the patterns. We will explain what each pattern is and how it captures the features of the program. But you have this information here. You can click on this and see an explanation of what this pattern means, and even learn more and see some examples in C and Fortran of how each of these patterns look like. Okay? So the tool is intended to help you in the analysis, design, and implementation of your parallel code, but also is designed so that you can learn what the tool is doing, so you can really learn from that and apply it to other codes in case that that code is not fully supported. Yes, as I told you, let me go back here. CMake, as a build system, you just have to probably type here make, that uses the make file automatically generated by CMake before. Okay? Okay. And even you can put in a script, and the script can run first CMake to generate the make file and later the make. It's up to you how you want to do it. Here you can put a simple command or a script that has a set of things at the terminal. Okay, Javier can help you with all of those things because he's very familiar with CMake and with any other build system. Okay, any other questions about this? Okay, great. So let me go back to the slides. Okay, so the idea of this part was essentially to show you very briefly how the UI looks like and how you can use the capabilities for the analysis of the code and the capabilities for the design and implementation of parallel versions of the code. And now there are many more features I have not shown, but we have the practicals to learn and explore more features of the tool. Okay? So now, before the break, we would like to cover this slide deck. That is the key part of the methodological approach based on patterns. Okay? This is what is completely different and you will not find, as far as we know, any other training course or any other tool that supports this concept of code pattern. And this concept of code pattern is what makes possible to the tool to automate the part of the analysis and to automate the part of the design and implementation of parallel code. Okay? So let's go into that. Okay, so the first question that you will say is, okay, why do I need to learn new things like patterns? And for that, we usually like to take some excerpts from the standards, OpenMP, OpenACC, to motivate what the standards can do for us. That is really great job, but what the standards clearly state that will not do for us. It's our responsibility to do it. OpenACC, and this is also applicable to OpenMP, does not describe automatic detection of parallel regions or automatic offloading of regions of code to an accelerator by a compiler or other tool. What it is saying, for the analysis part, OpenMP and OpenACC will not understand your code to say this pragma is correct or is incorrect. So the analysis is not addressed, is not covered by the OpenMP and OpenACC standards, as it is not covered by MPI, CUDA, any other API that you can use for parallel programming. This one, the hardware may not guarantee the same result on each execution. What this means is where we started. Do you remember that we said we started with four key differences between CPUs and GPUs? And we said the GPU has a more complicated memory design model. The threads are not executed all at the same level. They cannot communicate between all of them. So these two features have an impact in the programming model. And this is summarized here as the hardware may not guarantee the same results, because it's up to you, through the correct pragmas and correct clauses, to guarantee that the threads will be grouped in a given way and that the synchronization between the threads will be correct in these different levels of organization of the threads in the hardware, transparently to us. But we need to add the appropriate pragmas and clauses in OpenMP and OpenACC. Okay? Point number three, possible to write a compute regions that produces inconsistent memory results. This is a consequence of the first. If you do a specification in pragmas and clauses that is not correct, the compiler will do what it's instructed to do and will generate incorrect code. When you run it, typically your numerical results will not be correct, will be inconsistent, will change from one execution to another. This is a typical symptom that we see when there is a hidden race condition that has not been properly fixed or properly managed. Okay? And so, in the end, programmers need to be very careful that the program uses appropriate synchronization. So this is the feature of the hardware that has an impact on the results of our code, and it is us programmers who are responsible for fixing this by adding additional synchronization. The more basic one is atomic, but there are other ways of adding synchronization to our programs. So this is the way to fix these inconsistent results of the race conditions due to the hardware features. Okay? So in the end, what is he saying? You, programmer, you are responsible for doing a correct analysis, a correct design, and a correct implementation. OpenMP, OpenACC, MPI, any other parallel programming tool will just do what you tell it to do when you specify the pragmas and the clauses. Right? So in the end, we are responsible for making a good use of OpenMP and OpenACC, as it cannot be in a different way. So this is why code patterns are important. Because understanding the code, three lines of code, you may reason in terms of individual memory access, individual instructions. But when you go to large codes of thousands of lines or millions of lines, you cannot reason at that level. is very time consuming, but very error prone. So the patterns are a way to abstract the complexity of the real code and provide us an easiest way for us to reason about the semantics of the code and how to parallelize it. So the composition of codes into patterns is what we will see, helps to make good use of OpenMP or OpenACC, because the patterns specify what pragmas and clauses need to be added. We have seen it in this demonstration some minutes ago. Once the tool identified the scalar pattern, it was able to generate 4 or 5 different implementations using OpenMP and OpenACC of the same code, okay? And all of them correct. It speeds up the parallelization process because it addresses the problem of the analysis, it addresses the problem of the design and implementation of parallel versions. And it is more likely to get to result in good performance. Of course, the complexity of the hardware is so huge, the complexity of the software stack is so huge, that in the end, we need to generate many versions and make experimentation on different hardware platforms, because we can have different versions performing better than another when we change from one platform to another. Okay? So in the end, this experimentation is a part that we have to do. Great, so just to give us a set of steps of what we have to do. We don't do profiling. There are great profilers, great tools out there to help you identify those functions that are, those loops of the code that are the most time-consuming ones, okay? In the practicals, we will use gprof, but there are many others in the market. So we don't want to reinvent that wheel. There are excellent tools there. The next step is analyze for parallelism. Typically, we focus on loops, that is understanding the code in terms of components and what components do we have there. To reason in terms of components, not a distraction level. Once we have that, we implement the parallelism, in particular, adding the directives of OpenMP and OpenACC. This is what we're covering here. And finally, we need to benchmark the performance of the different versions, and if needed, further optimize the code using cache locality, using vector instructions, or using optimizing data transfer when we go to accelerator devices. Okay? And somehow we can repeat this if we have big code bases with several hotspots. It's an iterative process. So if we focus on the two main challenges that are the analysis part and the design and implementation part, then here is where the patterns come into play. So you start from sequential code. Next, you need to decompose it in components. We still need to see what types of components we need to consider. Once we have the components, we need to identify what patterns are actually present. Some of them will be parallelizable, some of them will not be parallelizable. So we will have later identified parallel patterns, and once we have that, we have everything we need to generate parallel code and continue performance, further optimizing and iterating again. So when we go into components, we essentially consider two types of components. If my code or your code is doing an FFT, why code in a new FFT? If you have excellent libraries, highly optimized by the vendors for every single platform. Just make a library call, reuse it, and you're done. A solver of a system of linear equations in parallel, very complicated to implement. There are solvers, parallel solvers for this type of equations. Let's use them, okay? So in order to try to agree on all the community in a terminology, we talk about components, scientific components. And these are typically kernel, scientific components. They are many different terms to refer to the same. So essentially it is a piece of science that it is available as a library call. So you have matrix-matrix multiplication on power system, on query system, on ARM system, because the vendors guarantee that they will port all these basic pieces of science and implement it in a very optimal way on that platform and make it available to us as programmers, just linking a library and making a library call. Okay? So let's not reinvent the wheel. But what happens if my code is not just an FFT? What happens if I have to take a matrix, make a matrix-matrix multiply, do something else that is not standard? I need to do it in my piece of code, then run an FFT or something else. There are pieces of the code that will not be available as library calls. So when you have that piece of code that is not available as a library call, this is what we call code components or code patterns. So here's where we talk in terms of the patterns that we are supporting the tool. Reductions, scalar, sparse reductions, for all, sparse for all, recurrence. We have up to 10, 15 different types of patterns, okay? So at this moment, we are supporting four types of patterns that are the most commonly used, the most widely used in real scientific applications, okay? So this is the difference. The parts of the code that are scientific, standard scientific pieces of code, consider if you want to make your own implementation, then you will have a code pattern, or if you want to replace that part of the code with a library call. It's up to you in the end, okay? We see developers that prefer to write their own matrix-matrix multiplication because they know exactly what the code is doing, and others prefer to just call a library, make a library call, okay? But library calls many times make many assumptions. In order to run that in parallel, you need to distribute the data or place the data in a specific way so that the library runs correctly. So some developers prefer not to go into that arena and code their own piece of scientific code because they know what the code is doing. Okay? But it is up to each programmer how they want to do it. So if you want to decompose your code, large or simple code, into components, first profile. We see in Appentra in Coruña, in Spain, every year we organize a hackathon where we test all of this methodology with people, teams of two people that come with real code, and we help them to accelerate the code for CPU, GPU, vectorization, and they usually get excellent results at the end of the week. And many times when we ask who in the room has profiled the application, many times no one raises the hand. This happens for two reasons. One, they usually don't know how to use a profiler and they prefer to focus on the science because they are coding sequential. And number two, they are experts in the science. And in some scientific fields, the scientist knows exactly where the hotspot is because this is common knowledge in the field, okay? So they know exactly where, even if without running a profiling, that the profiling will, the hotspot will be here. What we say to them is, okay, in either case, please double check that that is the hotspot, because sometimes you can get some surprises, okay? Not common, but you can get some surprises. So profiling. In the tutorials, you will have the opportunity to do it, but it's up to you, okay? Second, for each routine contained in an external library, remember, this is what we call scientific components. Again, it's up to each developer. Do I want to make the external library call? Or do I prefer to implement it myself? Take your decisions. This is, again, up to you. Point number three, for each routine coded by the programmer that matches one of these external library calls, just replace it or not. And the rest of the code is user-defined code. So essentially, you will have to deeply understand that code, in part of the code, in terms of code patterns, right? So somehow this summarizes what we have been saying in the previous minutes. So when we go from serial code to components, we now are focusing only on code that is not available or we don't want to call external libraries. We have to analyze it in terms of patterns. And we have three different types of patterns: computation patterns, memory patterns, and flow patterns. Today we will be focusing on computation patterns, but we will also introduce memory and flow patterns so that we can really understand the complexity of parallel programming and of high-performance computing. Okay, so types of patterns. Let's start with the computation patterns. And essentially, in the tool, we saw before a message like a scalar reduction pattern has been found. This means that somehow the tool has seen that the code matches this type of pattern. We have a scalar variable that somehow accumulates all of the values of a given set of memory locations. This is a very simple implementation, but imagine this in real code with a complex data structure across procedure faults, across files, across different classes, structs. The complexity of the real code may be really, really complex, but in the end, you may be computing just this simple pattern if you coded it with plain arrays, okay? This is what we try to summarize here. So let's see each of these, or some of these patterns in a bit more detail. But before, the question is, why using computation patterns? Computation patterns enable to ensure correct variable management in the parallel code. What this means, if I am able to identify that this complex loop, 1 million lines of code, in the end is computing a scalar reduction, the summation of a set of values, I know what I have to do with the variable that stores the summation at the end of the execution. I need to take it, run it in parallel, and protect its accumulation of a given value to that variable. Okay? This is the example that we have seen with the pie example. So in the end, you are managing what you have to do with each of the variables that you have in your code. And essentially, this is what OpenMP and OpenACC or MPI demand. You need to design for each variable how you manage it. Okay? So the computation patterns will tell you what to do with each of the variables that you have in the code. Computation patterns provide algorithmic rules to recode sequential code into a parallel equivalent code. We saw it in the example before. If we can detect a scalar reduction, and we nicely have a reduction clause in OpenMP and OpenACC, we know we can implement it just adding the reduction clause in the appropriate scope. Or we can decide not to use the reduction clause, share the variable, and make an atomic protection of the update of the variable, as the example we do see. So these are two simple alternatives to make a parallel implementation of the same parallel scalar reduction. But you have all the information you need to decide what to do with the variable and how to implement it in parallel so that the management of that variable is correct at runtime. And finally, computation patterns enable to code parallel versions for several standards and platforms. What we say, how we have to manage the variable is a concept, it's independent. If it is a reduction, if it is a summation, this is independent of the API that I use for parallel programming, right? So in the end, you can also use that information to make the implementation in this. And you can use MPI reduce, or you can use similar reduction operations that you have in all the parallel programming APIs. Okay, so this is why to use it. So let's just briefly see the difference between the patterns. The first pattern is a for all. What is a for all? Intuitively, every single iteration of the loop can be executed concurrently with any other iterations, and you will have no conflict, no race condition. Okay? So essentially, we can summarize this as a loop that produces a different array element on every single iteration. Okay? Again, remember, this is a pattern, the simplest coding of a code that is representative of a for all and that can be parallelized. Right? But always take into account that in general, you will have functions, classes, structs, many files, many functions that are called in each iteration. Okay? So the analysis part is very, very complicated in real applications. Okay, so in the end, what you have is each iteration can be executed in parallel because it produces a different element of the array. So you know that the array is an output variable and you know exactly what you do to do with it. Just share it between the threads. Each thread will write in a different memory location. No race condition at runtime. The second pattern, we have seen this. Remember the pie example we saw some minutes ago. Pi plus equals something. The difference here is that all the iterations produce a partial result on the same shared variable. If we don't do it in the appropriate order, we can miss the summation of partial results, and we can have incorrect results at the end of the execution. So this accumulation part is the typical scalar reduction. And scalar reductions are so frequent that they are supported in almost every single parallel programming MPI. MPI reduce, reduction clause in OpenMP and OpenACC, CUDA has support for reductions, all the even built-in features of programming languages have support for reductions. Okay? So essentially, the result is a reduction variable that we need to reduce. Reduce meaning that we need to accumulate all the partial results with appropriate synchronization to avoid missing accumulation of partial results. But there are different ways of implementing it, with atomic, with the reduction clause, and we also are supporting other alternative implementations for the same scalar reduction, right? So here we have in the tool the three parallel implementations that we are supporting right now. We have seen the built-in and the atomic. This is the reduction clause, this is the atomic pragma, but there is another one that is, maybe it's interesting that you explore it, and in the practicals that we will propose to you in the worksheet, you will have to explore this alternative implementation. That is, imagine that you have a reduction operation that is not supported in the standard. The standard supports some. You want to make a multiplication or a different operation that is associative and commutative. How do you do it if the reduction clause doesn't support it? You can go and use atomic. But atomic, depending on the features of the hardware and the code, can be much faster or can be very, very slow. So there is an alternative that is implement the semantics of the reduction clause, avoiding the atomic, with the other primitives or building blocks that you have in the parallel programming API. And that is what you can learn with this parallel loop with explicit privatization strategy, right? So for concepts, we talk about patterns, code patterns, parallelization strategies as something that is generic, independent of the parallel programming API. So each parallelization strategy can be later implemented using your preferred parallel programming API. Sparse reduction. This is a type of reduction that is very, very common in real applications. Who of you have worked here with molecular dynamics, finite elements, finite volumes? Finite elements, finite volumes, when you typically traverse the elements and you want to accumulate on the vertices that make a discretization of the continuous domain, essentially what you have in your code typically is a sparse reduction. So this is the type of reductions that if you look at OpenP, OpenACC, they say there are user-defined reductions that are not supported by the standard. This is an example of this type of very, very common reductions that are not supported by the parallel computing APIs. So we have a kernel specifically designed for this because it is so common in numerical scientific engineering that it needs to be handled, okay? So this is what we call a sparse reduction. Essentially, it's the same accumulation, but we call it sparse because the value of the element of the array where you will make the contribution, you don't know it at compile time. You only know that at runtime. So if you are very, very strict, very, very conservative, you will conclude this code has to be executed sequentially, cannot be parallelized, unless you know the values of C. If this is really a permutation, so no conflicts, or if they really point all of them to the same array element. But there are things you can do in the code to create generic code that will always be correct when you run it for every single value of C. And this is what you can learn with the parallel sparse reduction with the three possible implementations that we are supporting in the tool. So for those of you that have molecular dynamics, finite elements, finite volumes, this kind of scientific engineering field, the sparse reduction will be very, very useful for you to learn how to parallelize real codes, okay? And this appears in the Lulesh MK example that we have selected of the Cora Lulesh application, because it is based on finite elements. You will see a very complicated sparse reduction there, and you will learn how to parallelize it. Okay, I will skip this one. This sparse for all is typical to, is the same as the force for all, very simple example that we saw, but now with the sparse nature of not knowing what element will be written or modified in each iteration, okay? Again, you can parallelize this, generate parallel code that is correct and performant, performance depending on always, in any case, on the values of C at a given run of the code. So just to give you a summary, a bird's eye view, for each pattern, once you identify a pattern, let's say a scalar reduction, with the tool, you will be able to specify CPU multithreading, and you will be able to generate three different versions of the same code. When you go to the GPU and offloading, you will be able to generate two additional versions. So we are with five versions of the same piece of code. And even we also have support for tasking. So we are working on coarse grained tasking. This is work in progress. But for fine grained tasking, there is some work in progress, but you can even generate a tasking version of the reduction using the tool. And this essentially what is tackling this, the design space of the parallel implementations and also the actual implementation using OpenMP and OpenACC. It is helping you to quickly explore different versions, test them, benchmark them, and select the fastest one. Okay? Okay. I will also skip this. I usually skip it in the courses that I lecture. But I add the slide here because many times during the hands-on or questions after the during the coffee breaks, all of these discussions about pros and cons of each parallelization strategy for a given pattern come into play. So in the end, this is and will be very useful for you when you begin to apply this to your real code to reason about the pros and cons of each of the parallelization strategy or each of the options that you decide and consider. Okay, so let's skip the discussion, and if needed, I will come back to this slide if it's needed for the discussions. So finally, very, very briefly, we will not go today in memory patterns and in computation in data flow patterns, but I want you to be aware of why they are needed. Here, we are still deciding. There are probably 15, 20 patterns, but we have just distinguished two categories right now. The data structure design, and the actual data access pattern. For those of you that have vectorized code, usually a best practice recommendation is try whenever possible to use stride one accesses, because that is the best option for vectorization. So memory patterns will provide you that kind of information for every single reference to every single array that you have in your code, okay? But let's focus first here on the structure. What happens if you want to implement a set, represent a set of elements? You can do it with an array. You can do it with a tree, with a list, with a queue. How you store the data structure design is up to you, but you will try to choose the one that will perform faster and will be simpler to use. But essentially, you can code it as you prefer, okay? So the way you code the data structure design typically only has an impact on the complexity of the code or on the performance on the CPU. But on the GPU, this can break also your code. Because remember, you are transferring, copying data from CPU memory to GPU memory. So when you copy the data, if you have pointers of a tree, you will copy a node, the pointers will be valid on the CPU memory. When you transfer that, they will be broken on the GPU memory. Okay? So even designing the data structure, it's important to really understand when you go especially to the GPU, that without changing anything, your code can break and can be incorrect. Okay? This is the reason why we selected this forced memory pattern, and this was explained in detail in NERSC in California in the DOE 2 weeks ago, and we had a full day tutorial about only around data structure design patterns and how they detect this type of patterns in the analysis phase, okay, using Parallelware tools. If you're interested, we can send you, these links are public, we can send them to you, they have the materials that we have there, some of the sessions have recordings so you can see even me again, lecturing these contents to people there in California, okay? So do not hesitate to ask us for those links. So essentially, why memory patterns are needed, even if we don't, will not focus on them today? Memory patterns enable to exploit locality during the execution of the parallel code. Stride one or non-stride one access patterns. They exploit locality, they are good for cache, they are good for the GPU memory, or they are not good. So this is for performance, essentially. Memory access patterns provide rules to recode the data structure of the variables. Typical recommendation, try to avoid a struct of arrays. Try to avoid array of structs. Prefer a struct of arrays or plain arrays. This is the typical recommendation that you see in the tutorials for vectorization and for parallelization. This is related to the memory patterns, okay? And also, memory patterns enable the detection of errors, bugs in the parallel code. If you transfer a tree, transfer the nodes with the pointer values on the CPU memory, you will transfer the data, you will transfer the code to traverse all the tree, but the code will break on the GPU because the pointers are invalid. So you need to do something else to make the pointers consistent on the CPU, on the GPU, or change, re-engineer the data structure design. So knowing the memory patterns can even enable the detection of bugs in the parallel code in the analysis phase, even before implementing it, even before running it and seeing that it's correct, the results are numerically inconsistent. Okay? Flow patterns, very, very brief. Again, our code is an FFT, that's it. But typical finite elements, finite volumes, molecular simulations, we do simulations over time. So somehow, the final result starts from initial conditions and accumulates somehow some contribution to the final result in each iteration of the time step simulation. Okay? The time step simulation cannot be parallelized unless you use time parallel algorithms. But we are talking about doing different math, re-engineering the algorithm, not the code. Okay? That's a different approach to parallel programming that is, of course, very, very valid. But if you have a time step loop, then you typically can stop after a given maximum of iterations, or you usually stop under a given maximum of iterations, or when you are computing an error, the difference between using typically a mathematical norm between current iteration and previous iterations, if the error is less than a threshold, you say, I stop, I don't need 1,000 iterations, I can stop after 20 iterations. Okay? So this is what we call propagation loop, just a fixed maximum number of iterations, and the other is typically called by computational scientists convergence loop. They talk about convergence criteria of the algorithms. Algorithms that don't even never converge, or some of them converge, or converge fast, or converge very slow. So convergence loop is the typical code pattern that you find whenever computational scientists or engineers code this type of algorithms. So why using flow patterns is, understanding flow patterns is important? Flow patterns provide a deeper understanding of the reuse of data during the execution of the code. Remember that we said at the very beginning, we need to have three things in mind. Data transfers, when we go to the GPU, it's not the same memory, are two separate memory spaces. Transfer data back and forth. Computational code that is computational intensive. We need to offload computations that operate on that data and transfer the result back. But also we said, in complex code, let's try to avoid transfer data back and forth. What happens if a data is computed on the GPU, transferred back to the CPU, never used here, never updated, you transfer it in the next iteration of the convergence loop again to the CPU, GPU, recompute and have it back. Why making these intermediate transfers? Just place it on the GPU, initialize it there, and reuse it as many times as you want. Okay? So the flow patterns will help you to reuse the data, in particular on the GPU memory. And also, important, parallel patterns enable the detection of loops that cannot be parallelized. If you don't use time parallel algorithms, if the time step is a sequential algorithm, you cannot parallelize it. You already know this loop cannot be parallelized. Don't waste any effort in trying to do it. Consider changing the math, changing the algorithm that you are using behind the scenes. Right? Okay, so all of these things were explored in more detail in NERSC 2 weeks ago. Here I just wanted to show you more or less the landscape of the things we need to consider, and that is why parallel coding is so complicated. We cannot just focus on the computations. We need to focus as well on the memory design, how we have designed the data structure, and also how all of the code is executed, having a good understanding of the flow of the information during runtime. So you need to merge in your mind three perspectives: computation, memory, and flow. And when you understand all of that, then you can really code very, very efficient peak performance code. If not, you're missing something. Okay? So this is why we wanted to cover this, or at least present it today. So, okay, for the Pi example, let me add just with the same example Pi, with the scalar reduction pattern, let me just add how to generate the third parallelization strategy that will be using not reduction, not atomic, but it's something that you can learn from, because it's what you find in real applications, for instance, that use finite elements, finite volumes. This is the kind of parallel implementation that experts really implement in their sessions. Okay, so going back here, let me restore the original code. I am just undoing instead of restoring versions. And now let's... just click here, OpenMP, CPU, multithreading, and let's go into these three panels here. Atomic protection is, I want to specify that some will be protected with atomic protection. This is essentially what we saw before. So we are specifying exactly what we want to implement. You can see in the messages of the parallel work console, that the tool is telling you, I have identified this pattern for this variable, which is associative and commutative. This is the operator, this is the variable. So it is saying the parallelization strategies available in the tool, and it is telling you implemented the one that has been implemented according to your setup. So you can choose between atomic, reduction clause, or explicit privatization. Okay? So I have chosen atomic. Let's undo, just because it is faster for the demonstration. Let's choose built-in reduction. This is usually the default for scalars, where it is the same semantics, but now it has been implemented with a reduction clause. And again, in the console, you can see that now it says, okay, the number one strategy that was implemented is scalar reduction with the reduction clause. And finally, the third one. Is this explicit privatization? Sam? Look at the code. It's very different from the other ones. Essentially, you have the parallel, you have the for, you don't have the reduction, you don't have the atomic. What it's doing is what the experts typically do. They create private copies inside its thread, rewrite the algorithm to operate on the private copy, synchronize at the end of the for region, and then use atomic update instead of one time, one atomic per iteration, typically millions of iterations, one atomic only per thread, 10 threads, 100 threads. So the parallelization overhead is reduced to the minimum with this approach. Okay? So you can see these kind of three phases, the preamble, the code, and the postamble that creates the private copies, rewrites operating on the private copy, and each private copy is accumulated with atomic protection to the global result. Okay? And this is what we call the explicit privatization. And we are supporting this for scalars. I think I don't have the other another example here. But you can see it also. This is the Lules code. You will play with it. Let me choose this. Let me choose explicit privatization here so that you can see what is going on. Well, let me open another project. I think I should have it here. No, I don't have it here. Okay, I will do it with Lulish very fast. So essentially here is, this is a sparse reduction. You have the accumulation using this value that is essentially this indirect access here, okay? So when you click here, you can say, I want to use domain MFX. I want to handle it with explicit privatization, parallelize, and look at what the tool has done. All the variables not specified has been by default atomically protected, because every single of these arrays is a sparse reduction. So we have here 3 by 15 sparse reductions computed in every single iteration. But there is one that has been implemented using explicit privatization. So in this case, again, we have the three phases, the parallel region, the preamble is a bit more complicated because we are not just allocating a scalar variable and initializing it. We are locating a whole array, and then we are initializing all the elements of that array. Okay? Then the rewriting of the code is the same. We replace the original one referenced by the private copy, and in the end, we add the postamble. That is, the private copies are accumulated into the corresponding elements of the single original array. Okay? So this is the kind of understanding and learning that you can learn with this tool. Because one of the things we are working with the centers and with, in this case, with OpenPOWER to address the gap is when we learn with very simple examples, with Pi. when we go back to our code, we face the reality of real applications. The difference is so big that just understanding the code and trying to implement this is very, very time consuming. What we want to do with these tools is to make the training scalable and interactive so that you can really learn with example code that are very, very close to the reality of the code you will be working on when you're back at the office. Okay? So Lulish MK, this is real code of Lulish. Some simplifications are in other parts of the code, but not in this part. If you go to the Lulish and you download it from the website of Coral, of the DOE, you will find the same function with the same name, with the same piece of code. Okay? So this is what the tool can do for you, help you to learn real, how the experts are really coding real applications that you have out there. Okay, any questions about this? Do you have the opportunity to play with this after the break? So probably let's leave the questions for later. So to wrap up, there's one additional thing that I need to show you before the break. Give me 5 minutes. So essentially, what we want you to know is essentially the four main capabilities that you will find in Parallelware tools. We have seen discovering parallelization opportunities through in-depth static code analysis. These are the green circles. In real code, you have seen that. You have the code patterns. The tool reports the patterns. You understand the pattern. So you know exactly how to manage it when you want to go to parallel. So we have source code analysis guided through code patterns, not statement by statement or line by line. And in our website, we are creating a knowledge base that is public to share with the community and to build. We are working to build it and expand it with the community, where you have a description of the patterns that we have seen here. Okay, so it's not closed knowledge, it is free knowledge that we want to disseminate, and we want people to really give us feedback or the success stories or fail. For some reason it failed, didn't work in this example, just let us know so we can see if we need to define new patterns or split one pattern in more complicated patterns. And we all have also seen the quickly design and implement parallel code for CPU and GPU using OpenMP and OpenACC. What we tried is to promote best practices for parallel programming, guided by the patterns. We want to change the typical parallelization through happy idea. I have looked at the code and I said, well, I can do it this way. Let's code it and let's see what I find. Let's try to avoid that in the beginning. Let's try to have a deeper understanding, learn what the experts are doing, and then you decide if you want to apply your happy idea or if you want to further optimize a given strategy with one of your ideas to really make it run faster and better. Okay? So we are trying in both cases to promote best practices in parallel programming in the community. Okay? And there are two additional capabilities that I will show you in 5 minutes. Detection of defects in parallel code. What this means, if we can detect a pattern and use the pattern to tell you this is parallel and generate parallel code, can we use the pattern to see if you have already parallel code, if you have a reduction, if the reduction is not atomically protected? This is what we call a defect. And we are building and growing a knowledge base of defects here in this website. Okay? And this capability is also available in the trainer tool. And we also have another one that is suggestion of recommendations. A defect is something that is mandatory. You need to address it because it's something incorrect in your code. It's a race condition that will produce unstable results. But there are other things that it is up to you as a programmer if you want to follow the recommendation or not. If your code runs in parallel and you are storing the elements in a linked list and it works for you, it runs fast enough, why should you change it to a plain array? Is something mandatory for you? It is not. It's a best practice recommendation because you are exploiting better locality, so your code with very few changes will run much faster with the plain array than with the linked list. But it is not a defect. It's not something mandatory that you need to address. It's something that you need to consider and decide if you want to implement it or not. So this is what we call recommendations to improve the quality of your parallel code or to prepare the code before, during the analysis phase. Okay? So for this, we are trying to ensure compliance with best practices for parallel programming. As experts do it, try to learn that from the very beginning. And again, in this knowledge base, you will see and that checks two categories, defects and recommendations. And we have this also available in the tool for you to learn. So, very briefly, if we open a different project, that is this check examples, and if you open this example, or yes, this one, you can see not green circles, you see these exclamation marks here. What it means is that there is some recommendations, PWR, that you should consider adding here. For instance, one of the main problems is that to make it fast and easy to read, we typically don't specify all the shared variable reduction, all the data scoping for all the variables. We rely on the default assumptions of the standards. But this can change from one version to another. This changes from OpenMP to OpenACC. The default rules are not the same. So in order to avoid these very complicated hidden risk conditions, just because you change it from one standard to another, from one version of a compiler to another, and they are compliant with the standard, but they interpret parts of the standard in different ways, you should consider declaring all your variables here in data scoping. So here it is suggesting add default none to force the compiler to check that all the variables here are included in shared, private, or reduction clauses. So to understand this, you can click on this, and you are presented with a description of the recommendation, and even more important, how to fix it. We want to guide you to, so you know, the next step. How can I fix this recommendation to make my code, increase the quality of my code? And all this information, further information, this is available on the website. This public knowledge checks PWR, where you have the definition, the relevance, examples of code, related checks, related sources, reference of concepts you need to learn, all of this knowledge base. We are working to compile this knowledge and make it public so we can extend it and build it and grow it with the community. Okay? So for instance, if you use the tool and you find one defect or recommendation we have not identified, or a bug in one of them, please report it to us so that we can consider it as a different flavor of a defect, or we can create a different defect that covers that cases. We are beginning to work with the community to create this public knowledge base. Okay? And the labs in the US essentially are very, very interesting because there are already some efforts, ongoing efforts, in this direction. Okay, and finally, these are the recommendations, but look at this defect. This is red. This is stronger. You need to address this. What is happening here? You have a data transfer, parallel loop, work sharing. You are transferring A and B that are your arrays. But by default, you are not transferring the arrays, the data. You are transferring the value of the pointer in the host memory. So you transfer that value to the GPU memory and that will be broken. So you need, this is pointing you, you have code that is incorrect. It's a hidden race condition. So you have the description of the defect, how to fix it again, and of course, the further information in the website. Okay? Okay, and this is something that I wanted to finish before the break, because all of these capabilities, we are starting now with 4 defects and 8 recommendations, I think, but we already have internally identified 4 or 5 more defects, 6 more recommendations that we plan to implement and add capabilities in the upcoming months. We still are deciding and prioritizing our internal roadmap for these features. But more advanced things will come through these tools. Okay? Okay, and that is essentially what we wanted to share with you this morning. So these are the 4 capabilities that you will find in all our tools. The trainer and another tool that is called the analyzer that we should talk to you about that very, very briefly in the closed session. Okay. Okay. So, going back to the agenda, I probably have taken more time than expected. What's the time? Well, yes. Do you mind if we do the break now and then we start, or if you want to keep on working, what do you prefer? Sorry. The break. Perfect. So the break, and then we have, okay, let's take these 15 minutes of break now, and then we have the hands-on session, so it's up to you to freely play with the tool, ask us any question or anything you want to know about what we're doing and what it can do for you. And then we will wrap up with 10 to 15 minutes with this, and we will present you more information that we want to share with you before the end. So do you plan to stay until 1, or do you plan to leave before 1 p.m.? You will stay until 1 p.m.? Okay, so I will give you this then. And the three of you, will you stay until 1 p.m.? Yes? You're here. And both of you, will you stay until 1 p.m.? Okay, great. Okay, let's stop here.
Okay, so we have almost a bit less than 1 hour ahead. I hope that even though we have taken a bit more time on the first time, it was really interesting for you to understand the concept of what and how we propose to do things. So now we move on to the hands-on time. So you have two pieces of paper, a survey. Please don't go out of the room today without giving us that feedback. Honest feedback, sincere feedback, good, bad things, we need to improve. So anything you can tell us, please let us know. And even if after the event you find something, do not hesitate to drop us an email, providing us any kind of feedback you think might be interesting. So you have an additional piece of paper that is this worksheet, where essentially the idea is, instead of you playing freely with the tool, we provide you a sequence of steps with Pi, very simple example, and with LULSMK, quite complicated for training and session of half day, 1 day tutorial. And essentially we propose you a set of step-by-step work that you can do, so you can somehow make a walk through all the main features that you have in the tool, okay? And also to facilitate, finally, what you are looking for, faster applications. You can register here, running the code on your laptops or the remote system, and take note here of the runtime that you get whenever you try different setups or different possibilities with the tool, okay? And then you have the longer example, that is the LULSMK, again with a final table at the end where you can write the runtimes of your experimentation. And of course, the worksheet is for you to take it away with you, okay? Next then, all of you have the trainer installed because they have some issues with the connection, remote connection. Our apologies about that. But in the US, they are sleeping at this moment, so difficult that they can help us with that. So you have already activated the trainer locally. You have a license. If you have an issue, just let us know. You already know the tool. So this is what we propose you. Parallelizing PNLish using the worksheet. So essentially, you will need to fill in, understand lines, loops, in terms of patterns and types of patterns that you can find. Okay. For Pi, it's very simple, there's the scalar reduction. But for LULES is an application from Coral Benchmarks in the US, Hydrodynamics, quite complicated code where you need to compile it and run it. And in order to verify that the result is correct, you just need to focus on these figures to see that the result is correct. If these numbers change, you have made something wrong in the parallelization. Your numerical result will be incorrect. And here you have the lapsed time. That is the one you need to register to see if you can run it faster locally or using the GPU. And of course, if you want to profile it, you can do it. If not, I can leave this here. You just have to run this command to find the hotspot, and you will see that it has been designed so that essentially the main computational time is concentrated on three functions. This is the case of LULES code. And one of them takes up almost 60% of the time. And then you have several patterns that you need to identify with the help of the tool and understand why is this kind of pattern and how you can parallelize it using that information. And then what's the idea? That we can fill in a similar table like this. Or you have all of these loops, all of these functions. So for each variable, you need to identify each of the patterns. So you know, we can tell you will have a convergence loop through a pattern. You will have a sparse reduction, the one that I used for my demonstration before the break. And you will also have scalar reductions and forwards. So you have a bit of everything, of all of the patterns, and you can combine different strategies for different patterns in the same parallel implementation. So that you can incrementally improve the performance of the loop. Okay, so feel free to play with it or to follow the worksheet as we have in there. And all the materials are here that you already have. So, okay, get started and let us know where and what you need help. 10 minutes before 1 p.m., we will stop and we will wrap up and discuss how far you have reached. We'll show you some results we have measured on the power system so we can really think about the effectiveness of the course. Okay? Okay, let us know what you need from us.
So, where can we find all the slides?
In the public website, if you click on here.
I just took a photo of this.
I think you have it in the. Okay, but yes, please, type it. And then you have all the materials.
And there we also find the additional slides about data flow patterns and.
Yes, all the slides that I use here today.
And the sample.
They are available there.
The code. The code should be there too. So, in order to experiment with the code, download it from that website. It's on the shed. Okay, the shadow.
Yeah. Hidden slides.
Uh-huh.
Yeah.
This is the event. And if you come here, you scroll down, you have all the materials here. Okay. This is what we used yesterday for the installation. This is what we call the promotion package. Essentially, we try to update it to include relevant links about the trainings we have been doing, recordings, materials. You can have more information than the information that we have shown today. These are really the real slides I have used today. And then this is the worksheet and these workshop examples that we proposed today. Py, Lunes, MK, and there are additional ones like Badmoor or HIP. We have them here. Okay?
And then I have a question, a more general question about the experiences you have made in your daily work. So, what is the status of OpenACC versus OpenMP? So,
okay.
And how many Fortran code is out there?
Okay, let's start with our roadmap to support the three main programming languages: C++, and Fortran. Historically, we have tried to cover from the very beginning C and Fortran. But we are using to create the Parallelization tools, we are building this on top of a community effort that is called LLVM, a group of it, LLVM ecosystem, cloud ecosystem, and there is a lack, historical lack of Fortran support for the LLVM ecosystem. So this is why the tools right now have mature support for C, and we are beginning now to have support for C, for Fortran. Because the ecosystem is beginning to mature in the LLVM to have Fortran support. Front-end to for the Fortran programming language. So in practice, the current release 1.3.1, C is mature, C++ is not yet supported, Fortran is supported to detect some defects and recommendations, but not for the generation of parallel code. Okay? And this is work in progress, has been the major challenge during this year. So we are now finishing the development internally. It's already an alpha version internally. We plan to release it in January, early February. It will have a new update of the tools, 1.4 probably, with the same SIP support, Fortran support in the generation state. So you can take this Py example, for instance, and generate different parallel implementations of it with Fortran syntax of OpenMP and OpenACC. That's our goal. And also C++. But C++, we are constrained in this upcoming version to discover. We want to help in analyzing real code. And this is a mixture of C, C++, and Fortran. So usually, when you look at the hotspots, you can see that even in C, C++, Fortran code, you have C-like kernels, hotspots, Fortran-like kernels. you don't really see people using advanced features of C++ in the hotspots because data locality is poor, these kind of things. So having this feedback in mind, what we plan to release in 1.4 in February is support for C++ projects on Fortran, and in C++ code, discover opportunities, defects, and recommendations in C code inside C++ files. This is the first step to support C++. After that, once that is mature and stable, we will incrementally improve C++, okay, during the next year. So that regarding the languages. Regarding the pragma generation, essentially for OpenMP and OpenACC, essentially are at the same level in terms of offloading. Because OpenACC has essentially been designed for offloading, although now it has also evolved to use multi-threading on the CPU. So, but it has been designed with OpenACC with offloading in mind. So we are supporting essentially the equivalent features in OpenMP and OpenACC for offloading. And in OpenMP we go beyond that. We support multi-threading, tasking, which is not supported in OpenACC. And for now, simulation, vectorization is something that will be become further down the road. Are you looking for some specific feature you need that we can give you more details? It's essentially the status.
No, I was just asking because I think OpenACC will be dead, right? Pray, talk to support, and so on.
It depends on who you speak to in the community. If you think that OpenACC is backed by Orange National Lab in the US, Jack Wells is the new president of OpenACC or something like that, they are really pushing and investing a lot of resources in improving OpenACC. Why? Because although it seems that, this is something personal opinion,
yeah.
OpenMP is growing to be very, very large, it's covering everything. OpenACC kinds of specializes in offloading and now it's moving towards multi-threading. The key difference between the two standards is that OpenACC is very declarative. You say, I want this, and the compiler does the rest. OpenMP is more prescriptive than declarative. You say, I want to do this, but you need to specify how to do the things for the compilers to work. So from the point of view of usability, you can see in the tool, OpenACC code is easier to read, easier to understand, a more compact implementation, while OpenMP is more verbose and more difficult to understand. So, from the point of view of capabilities, it seems that OpenMP will cover everything. But OpenACC is ahead of OpenMP in mature compiler support for offloading, and it's more easy to use than OpenMP right now.
So, many
who will die? The civil happens.
Yeah. How many of your customers use OpenACC versus how many use OpenMP? Do you have a feeling or numbers or so?
I can tell you the reality. The customers, particularly the lighthouse customers, Nest in the US, Cal in Saudi Arabia, they have purchased our tools and has hired our services for training, motivated by GPU, because they have upcoming machines, big supercomputers based on GPUs.
So the new machines are with GPUs. Before that they were CPU only?
Mostly CPUs. So the major decision, strategic decision in the centers is moving to supercomputers with the latest GPUs available at that time. So if you take, look at, from that perspective, for them it's a strategy to take the applications of the users and run them faster on these systems. OpenACC is much more mature than OpenMP in this sense.
So they will use OpenACC?
So they have our service saying, we want to use OpenACC for GPUs here. So we began the conversations to prepare the materials. At some point they said, can we cover OpenACC and OpenMP? And we said, yes, we can cover it.
Yeah.
Because the concepts are the same or similar. It's just a matter of syntax. And then we come to the experimentation. And in the experimentation, the reality, at least during this year, is that when you test all of these codes on real machines with real GPUs, the OpenACC implementation runs much faster than the equivalent OpenMP implementation on the same machine. So from the user perspective, why using OpenMP and not OpenACC for the same effort, it will run faster? Okay? But the centers still want to cover OpenMP because it seems that it will be in the end the standard that will survive, but nobody knows it. Okay?
Yeah.
So in the end we are covering both so producers.
I mean the point is if Gray says okay we drop OpenMP, but there could be a sign and then probably I will not invest on that.
I see.
But on the other hand, if the migration path is straightforward, which probably is
from one to
it's not that hard.
Not that hard in terms of translating the problems and the process.
Yeah.
But then you come to the actual execution and the difference in performances.
Yeah, sure. I mean you can say the OpenACC until OpenMP will eventually
That's a potential possible point. Yeah.
Curious thing is that now OpenACC is also aiming at OpenMP because they are targeting the CPUs now, which is like okay, now you are converging both of them to the same thing.
Yeah.
Because OpenACC was filling that gap that OpenMP had. But now it seems that OpenACC also wants to run multicore. So it's like, okay, you are stepping on each other. The actual thing would be.
So that would be the best thing. There could be a merger or something.
Yeah.
But that's really.
Yeah,
is
they are so similar that they should just merge. That's
yeah,
something.
Really.
The industry will eventually decide. For instance, OpenMP and OpenACC, there were 15 to 8 years ago other sets of partners. Intel had a native set of partners, Cray has some, HMPP of a company called Caps Enterprise in Europe was also a competitor of this. Somehow, all of this same approach based on directives for the same problem. So, how have converged into two, OpenMP and OpenACC? And they seem to begin to overlap. So, within 10 years, from the user perspective, they will eventually converge into one. Indeed, OpenMP 5.0 has this parallel for. OpenACC has the parallel loop. From a high level perspective, they are the same in the sense that you say how to share distributed iterations between the threads. But if you look at the details, OpenMP, the form dictates exactly how the iterations are mapped to the threads. Loop doesn't dictate anything. It's up to the compiler to decide how to map it. What is happening? In OpenMP 5.0, you have form and something new that is called loop. And somehow it's declared in the sense of OpenACC. And you have the four that is the traditional, the legacy four directive of OpenMP. So they are somehow covered. But as a path for to solve your problems today, it seems that many centers are saying, go to OpenACC, mature compiler support, it will be performant. And the translation from this to OpenMP eventually should be easy. Or there will be tools that will help you to make the jump from one to another. And regarding the lack of support for Cray, the community is also pushing very, very hard that GCC supports OpenACC. It is GCC is getting very, very mature and very, very fast. There are resources injected in a company, I think, I can't remember the name, but they are maturing the OpenACC runtime for GCC. So again, if Cray decides not, Intel decides not to support them, you have GCC that will mature, which is expected to mature fast. In terms of running faster and performant way, the same thing. So it seems a good path at this moment.
So, but very few people want to write a CUDA code. I mean, there would be alternatives, right? To say, I have the kernel, I won't put it in the kernel, so I rewrite it in CUDA, but that's not the case, right?
CUDA is very, very complicated. If OpenMP is complicated, if MPI is complicated, POSIX thread is complicated, you are more at that level. With the complexity of the GPU hardware, and you need to manage it, and you need to know how to manage it. So, to get started, I can program the GPU, and I have never programmed it. While you have the concept, you know what you're doing, so you can go up to a level of performance. And of course, if your application is critical to reach higher performance, then in OpenMP and OpenACC you will feel constrained because you can only do what the programmers and crews enable you to do. So at some point, if you require this additional 20% peak performance, not the case for many, many people, only for a few people, then you will be able to, you should combine OpenMP or OpenACC with CUDA or similar language. The standards are designed to be compatible with the underlying language. So you can mix your code, CUDA, and OpenMP or OpenACC. That's how the tools are being designed, the specifications are being written. But in terms of the, today, we are constantly in these trainings. Every single training we do, we run all our examples in different systems. Javier is doing that work, and he can tell you directly the experience in terms of the conclusion, in terms of matureness of the compilers, easy to use, performance that you get. Maybe you can have more than I can.
I lost track of your conversation for a moment, but you're still talking about OpenMP, OpenCC. For me, at least, the OpenCC part is kind of paradigm. The OpenMP is quite easy because both the VCC, VDI, and possibly the plan is supported. But for OpenCC, my recommendation and our recommendation in these sessions is just use VDI. VDI is backed by NVIDIA. So it's the cutting edge compiler for OpenACC related stuff. So that's my advice. Use that. For GCC, for instance, yesterday I was doing some experiments with my computer. It crashed on Linux. Depends on the driver. Depends on the GCC implementation. The GCC you have in most of the Linux systems, it doesn't come with support for, because since they want to be open and target any system, they don't want to be tied to NVIDIA. You require a specific compiler to compare to PDX, to NVIDIA PDX. So that's another point. Mostly never you have a GCC compiler with that support. So you have to build your own or resort to some out of the bound package list. In general, I would say use plan of GCC for OpenMP, don't worry too much about it. But if you want to go the OpenGCC way, you have to use PDI and NVIDIA, and that's it. So it's not, we always talk about GPUs in general, but we are really all, everyone is saying NVIDIA really, because that's what's important nowadays.
The most major ecosystem, right?
Sorry?
The most major ecosystem.
But also what you will hear is, well, since you are doing NVIDIA, why don't you use CUDA? Well, CUDA, as he was saying, is way higher. This higher level, we are trying to not get in the way of not making you rewrite your code. You want to keep your code as it is and just parallelize it without having to rethink everything to adapt to the CUDA architecture
execution models. And I mean, if you write it in OpenACC, for example, if one day AMD gets competitive, you can switch.
I have some hopes there because they are now coming back really well with the GPUs, also in the like in the graphics sector, they are pushing hard. Like next PlayStation, Xbox, I think they are going with AMD. I mean, there's some traction there, and that should also relate to the computer from the GPUs. Same with the multi-core machines, and the Threadripper, they are pushing hard to come back to the fight. But compilers, that's another battle. NVIDIA is backing hard PDI, so PDI is NVIDIA, it is OpenACC, and that's it.
And NVIDIA is maturing the ecosystem because the big centers in HPC, the DOE and all the Julie Supercomputing Center in Germany, and I think it's also in Japan, Riken, they are the three major centers in the areas that are behind OpenACC. Why? Because they have big applications that want to run them faster, on the millions of dollars of investments in the machines.
And all the smaller ones look at those meetings and well, what they are doing as well.
Exactly. Let's say that these big centers are pioneering in doing that. They know they have to make strong investments in the hardware, but also in the software stack to mature the tooling and the ecosystem around it to make it usable for their big applications. And this, in the end, benefits all the community that comes behind following that. And OpenACC is backed very, very strong by the centers.
Yes.
Good.
Several layers of structures. The top one is the vendor symbols. But we're beginning to explore and find different ways of collaborating with university, with different ways, as it exposes different layers of the API to use it to make research for the program models, for instance. If you, some people is making research in asking from the point of view of asynchronous execution. If you can detect that a given piece of code, you have two parts of code that are sequentially executed within a function, but there is no flow filter to them. Can we somehow expose an API that we can provide you? This function can be described as these two pieces of code competing with them. You can use them for other purposes or functions. So, with this kind of research groups working at this lower level, we are beginning conversations to say that not only the commercial, not only the high level of structure of the partners, everything that is behind can be of interest to you. Why? Because we can be partners in employees, and we can provide you with production level tools so you can speed up your research and speed up your knowledge. So this is something also to consider. Just keep it in mind, you know exactly what you are doing.
So
what is the concept?
So what we're doing with Powerware is more static code analysis. So what we are currently implementing is dynamic code analysis. So that when we have running sample data and even structure tracing, we can find out are there parts of sample data. But I mean, it's the interesting because of the static code analysis we have in your book.
Indeed, we are also starting collaboration with companies that are working in dynamic analysis. For instance, dynamic analysis has the advantage that you can apply it to a particular feature of the number four because you are somehow in the code instrumenting and tracing every single operation memory. You don't have to fight with catching up with the new features of programming.
Yes.
Just say, read operation instrument and the rest of it. So, static analysis, the big challenge is to catch up with the new features. So we are always behind in terms of the number of percentage of programming and the feature that we can support. That's not a problem for them. But another the problem is that if you want to run a real code from GPU, from complex hardware, your traces become very, very slow.
Yeah.
So one of the things that some companies are interested in, we know and we all agree that for the user perspective, idea is dynamic to have more information and this is so we need to accelerate. Can we accelerate with a static code if you can prove the static code? So you can prove from
several
sensors
where you don't need any such.
And we're starting to find ways of collaborating with companies and research. Very important projects of data specific projects.
And I mean also the memory analysis is good if you have a representative work.
Yes. So in general, the host, a complete solution for the user is, should be a combination.
Yeah.
I have talked about this with many different professors. And at the end of the conversation, we are agreed on.
Yes. Very seldomly, the one tool fits all of the several tools.
So, first of all, one of the things we are now exploring is applying this step to an axis. There is a gap in tooling that we have identified. We have had conversations in with forwards, with mesh, with code server, with home, or the big labs that we can do. And if you want to use data verification for public code, you need to use a threat analyzer, you need to use symptom inspector, you have four or five tools that are dynamic. But dynamic tools are slow, but they're using DCP. DCP you cannot use. Why? Because you cannot trace thousands of threats in computer in your head. It's not practical. You can do it, it's not practical. The response might be so slow that the labs are looking for solutions of how to make it run faster, even using some precision. And that's where the meds have to come into. So we are beginning to show that the detector I showed you here is an example of a very simple code that would take minutes or hours with all of these analytics to detect a risk of hidden risk. We can prove it in just 1 second. This so essentially, we are beginning to explore if we can build a big static data representation for GPUs because there is no tool dynamic that occurs. In the end, of course, the dynamic plus the data will be less. But this is a feature that is missing. For itself, maybe a good, very good topic for a PC, but for us, it's a very good innovative way of using the data.
Yeah. You also look at PGA.
For FPGAs, we are involved in two very specific projects. One is called Maestro, the leader is not involved in big data from the Jewish Security Center. You are in Germany?
Yeah, Jewish.
Jewish is a very recognized leader in this field, and he's leading this project. And the idea there is to use the static code analysis and some dynamic analysis to make intelligent data movement transparent to the user, to compare your code with OpenMP. And behind the scenes, there are types of to move the data where the people are. So this is very, it's been a very research experience, but it's an innovative application of static code analysis. The other project is called EPIC, and this is led by Barcelona's people. And essentially here what we are thinking is using the static code analysis instead of focusing on the OpenMP and OpenACC particularly, wiring into the FPGA.
So identifying parts code which could be offloaded.
The analysis part is partially the same, because in the end, very familiar with HLS, high-level synthesis. High-level synthesis, you have partners that say dependence, no dependence, or temporal. So you need to tag somehow variables. And you need to analyze the behavior of the code in the user of the so in the end, the semantics of the HLS partners and process use is the classical data dependence of output dependencies, tree dependence, and dependencies. But these patterns are completely related. So we can translate the pattern language into that. So essentially we are detecting templates. What this means is that you can say in HLS for FPGA, you can say create this region on the FPGA. And all this computation, whether the result is better or is available, is a temporary computation. This means that each iteration overrides all the positions of the data. What this means is that when this specification is synthesized, each thread of the FPGA, or how the FPGA decides to create a hardware, it can use separate things to recompute different values for the different instances of it. So it's a
different way of implementing the practice people are not. So with all of these ideas in this stupid project, we are exploring how with what we already have, it is useful for open privacy, for data movement and for prioritization, how we can use it for privacy. So within next year we will make calls on that.
But that means we have to rewrite the code in JLS kernel.
Yes, but we are working on code. So we need one of the goals we have for the project is to understand first, can we analyze and understand the code and have all the information we need to make decisions to go to the principles. Once we have that, we will begin with simple codes. Once we have that, we say okay, now have what we need to do to write the code to the principles. And then there will be things for it that the developer will need to write. And something that can be guided or can be amended. And this is what we really
say. So to make it the life more easy for the developer, or as easy as possible.
And you think of, in terms of what we said, capabilities of the technology, we said recommendation of defects and code writing. We're talking about code writing, but why not, if you have information, verify that your ACS implementation is correct. If you say there is no dependence of this layer and this other temporary, it's a reduction, come according to a defect in your ACS. So again, this approach of defects recommendations and code writing can be applied to any, to many.
That's highly thinking of you on GPUs. That's an area which is not interested in GPUs, but which can be a nightmare in the case if you have some operations which take way too long and you have too high latency. So it's a pipeline state, so you can make the run faster in terms of quantity, but just increase the design by getting more I think HLS tries to do it because it can use some kind of target clock period that would which would operate, but sometimes it is necessary to write the code in a specific way that it recognizes what to do. So we're just working with Manuel HLS, so there are other HLS solutions perhaps that are more fine-grained in the control yet. Mm-hmm. But with Manuel HLS it's not only part of the pragmas that we use, but also sometimes you have to restructure your code to make it realize what you want to do. So I think that's also a problem that
well, that's another dimension which is actually
but it is relevant if you want to auto-generate code for this particular type of HLS compiler because it's not quite tricky in this case.
I assume we haven't started yet the phase of analyzing that in detail, but I assume that it will be significant to code writing to really get high performance.
On the other hand, I expect that more professional tools are pretty well available, like all these EDA tool manufacturers that also have their own HLS solutions. Perhaps they are more mature in that sense, so it might be easier to generate problems for them.
The thing that I have come on maybe that we have said yet is that in the end, as it depends on the analysis phase that we would like to use, in the end, it relies on similar and make the analysis. So in the end, again, the same problem as conversation. That's time consuming and from a public opinion. And there is a lot of room for improvement in that. As far as I can talk, right?
So
only
your main the area of HPC, I suppose.
Yes, we are starting from that, but we are starting also to try to enter in the territory. Because again, it is not important if you see low level analysis in the organization. But embedded high performance in the sense that even though you usually have hundreds of threads already coded in parallel, but the main problem is to find databases or make this conversation very, very fine way. But high performance embedded is all of these hundreds of tasks with one or two very time consuming. How this is intervening, how all of them coexist to really provide real time response. So, this new workload that comes from this PC is new in the heart of most of it. We are beginning to also explore it. And for that, we are starting to contact companies like operations because they are
The good news of working in statistical analysis is that the bad news is that it's very, very challenging for something. And every update of the standard of accordingly is of a pattern, you need to be part of that. So there are many dimensions, many different ways, things that you have to jump on to make progress. But in the end, something so that you are proving very fine in the code is not running if it has a property. It's another thing to find what properties are key or relevant for a given problem. And then you can answer the problem. It's very exciting to work in.
Do you see also new languages appearing on the screen, anything like Julia or
You think it's gonna solve, it's gonna Julia, do you think it's gonna be successful sometimes? But also I said some demo one Julia.
For Julia, it's this kind of languages that in research and SPC are hot topics. We are probably addressing very, very important issues. But when you talk to corporations, they say, OpenMP.
We need to wait another 10 years and then we talk about it. But I mean, the HPC guys are always a little bit ahead of competition.
Yes,
right?
They are the leading edge, looking for new innovations at the end, 10 to the other day. Will eventually translate around to something.
But do you think that anyone would want to adopt anything like Julia outside? Outside something still familiar with move directly towards Julia?
I don't know. I mean, in theory, Julia is more abstract and easier to program, perhaps easier to maintain the code. So, so it has some value. And I don't know, the thing is how many code in HPC is newly written?
I don't know.
On the other hand, Julia is totally compatible with C libraries. You can call Fortran functions, you can call C++ functions. So you can integrate it pretty often, pretty well.
Python. What you have said is to have the same argument for Python.
But Python is slow.
Yes. And Julia is what?
Julia is compiled. Interpreted, we have this global interpreter log, which means it's basically zero threaded, and Julia is multi-threaded. So there are a lot of interesting aspects.
Okay.
If they will be used in the market.
Yeah, I think it is.
I don't know either.
It's been quite a few years now. There is not so much noise about it anymore.
I mean, it started in what, 2014? so it's what, 5 years old? That's
a baby.
That's nothing.
It's a baby that is beginning to to creep.
So perhaps we need to wait.
But in the industry is very, very pragmatic. For instance, things like OpenMP, OpenACC, you talk to big corporations, Siemens, and say, do you use this? They say, really? How did you solve the problem? They have developed their own solutions, APIs, that essentially have the same building concept, prioritization, work sharing, but they implement it in a different way. And in the end, these implementations have something different and are basic. If they are not even using things that are in the market for 20 years, like OpenMP, very easy to use, they are at a lower level because they probably have very strong reason to be at a lower level. Why using Julia as a completely new experimental? It will take too long.
I still have abstraction with Python. But the key with Python is that you get great libraries that are implemented in C. So if you find one of those libraries, it's very quick to develop in Python and call those libraries. And the problem is once your problem can be solved with that library, or you have an algorithm that is computational intensive, and probably that maps to Julia. So the thing is that if you have a FFT, you have a mass multiplication, there are libraries for that. You don't have to do that yourself, and you will be okay with Python. Even Python now has some tasks, so you can actually have some threading too. But if you have to implement a complex algorithm, like convergence loop or something like that, and you have to manage memory, then you, what do you go with? C, C++, Fortran, probably some other languages too, hopefully someday Rust too, but you have to, it, when you have to get your hands dirty with pointers on memory, then it is what it is. And no, I think no Julia, Python, R, no high level language is going to give you that. Not even, I mean, of
Java,
.NET. You have to go back to
languages. Right? Like, indeed, these languages like Python, Julia, are very aggressive for the user. In the sense, do you know that from Python 2 to Python 3, they have broken backwards compatibility?
Yeah,
like, I have seen that in ERSC. All the users are forced to adapt the code for Python. They will not even compile. Probably because behind the scenes there are strong reasons that are related to these issues. And they said,
yeah,
if I do backward compatibility, in the long term I will lose the race. Mm-hmm. I have to make hard decisions right now. Yeah. And they are probably moving that direction very, very with hard decisions for the user perspective.
Yeah, I don't know, they changed it, I think, for a long time. After that, refused to ship Python language. Well, of course, they will change that now.
I've seen that, we've seen that in Cori last week. Last this month, they announced that all the users need to migrate to Python 3 if they want to run on their supercomputer. Very, very aggressive.
The biggest change from Python 3 is the print function.
The
print function.
Yeah,
yes.
With the many change
brackets.
Yeah. But no, I mean, every time, I mean, Python, you will be very tight to any version. Like, if you use features from Python 3.7, you will be locked in. Python 3. So, I mean, it was about time to move on.
Mm-hmm.
But funnily enough, the biggest change is a print function.
It's a print function. Okay. Have you been digging into the details? It broke backwards compatibility.
Yeah.
Which is hard from a programmer's perspective.
And just like you're saying, like most new C++ deep libraries I see today, almost when it gets matured, you see the Python interface, sorry.
I know.
Like TensorFlow, you see, immediately. But a big, big project in C++, you give the Python something.
I mean, all the big data scientists,
yeah,
they all use Python.
Yeah.
And also, in a very big fashion, I mean, if you analyze, I don't know,
Yeah. Yeah. Yeah.
But it is the library, the ecosystem, or Anaconda.
Yeah.
It's implementation, that's the key. The language is really friendly, it's to use, but the heavy lifting is being done by the library. So if you are going to start doing a loop in Python and that's where your science happens, then you are screwed. I mean, you can coordinate the work, but you cannot implement an efficient loop there.
Well, I mean, if you have the library and use Python just for orchestrating the different library calls and routing the data flows, but I don't know. I would say there is a lot of performance wasted by using Python. And
but this is, I mean, this is where we thrive actually as a company. This is the problem that we find. Most of the people using HPC, they are not programmers.
Mm.
So you cannot ask them to write efficient, low-level memory management code.
Yeah.
That's why they resort to Python. They are really happy. Oh, this is really friendly. I experiment. It works. It's like JavaScript. It just works. I hate it, but it works. Right.
So I can prove that my algorithm is correct, right?
Yeah.
in a very fast
class. I want to do my science. I do not want to learn programming. I do not care if the GPU is like this or the CPU. I
don't even want to see code.
Sorry?
They don't even want to see code like someone else. No, scientists don't want to see code.
Yeah.
And also, it is the academic world. As academics, we have all the time in the world to solve a problem. In industry, you have the arguments of doing things.
And the same conversation goes to CUDA and OpenACC. It's the same. Of course, if you want to take the most of the GPU, go to CUDA. That's the lowest level.
Mm.
No discussion. But do you really want to get your hands up there, change, refactor your code that much? Or do you want to just put a couple of directives there, or even if there's 5, 10 directives, and keep your algorithm as it is and understand it. Not worry about calling a lot of queues at
once. You lose 20% of performance, but perhaps that's better.
Yeah.
And you don't have to rewrite your kernel once a new GPU.
And if someone comes and has to understand the code, maybe it's understandable, but we could have.
And even in the worst case, there's computational scientists will come with your OpenACC implement. That happened to me when I did my master's thesis 20 years ago. We took a very computational intensive hydrodynamics application, and the project was to accelerate it using distributed vector machines. At that point, they were a good one. So we implemented something very, very efficient with pragmas, with intrinsics, with MPI, with PVM at that point. Very, very efficient. And we delivered this to the computational scientists and said, oh, great, we want to make great research on this. We made documentation. They never, ever involved that code. Why? Because they didn't really understand it. They finally went back to other versions, older, and they could understand and modify. So if even in the worst case, you have OpenACC implementation, OpenMP, and they don't understand it, just remove the pragmas, they understand the sequential code, and they can keep on working. It's an extreme scenario, but it's even worse to have a code that they can even understand and months of development just to the trash because they don't really know how to code, how to modify the code. And that is happening every day in the service.
That's
what it is. Yep, exactly. Exactly. Okay, great, great. Great discussion. Good time.
Almost
what?
Yeah, let me then. Who did the worksheet?
That's a discussion. That's the discussion was also very interesting.
Yes. The worksheet you can do it at home.
Yeah, we can do it at home.
I'm interested. I do not hesitate to contact us, okay? So let's close. I would like to give you some additional hints about what we're doing. We are supposed to have covered all of this, and we almost did. So we really were able to cover what we said in the beginning of the session. And of course, next steps are to have many, many other things we can discuss, we can learn, we can cover. You have the materials. These are some results that Javier conducted on his laptop, on the two thing machines that you should have access today. So you can see the pike sample with this number. It is accelerated with acceleration only on the CPU with multicore, with multithreading. And even you can go further to the GPU and further reduce that time. PGI OpenACC seems to be the better approach to what we do. Okay? But you can improve your numbers even with very simple code to learn all these things. So we talked already about this. We have four main capabilities. Remember the defects and the recommendations, discovering the opportunities to in the analysis phase, and also quickly help you to design the parallel implementation. We would like to let you know another thing, initiative we have just started. As the static code analysis has so many applications, the trainer and the pattern concept is something that is very costly behind the scenes. We are taking decisions about memory, control flow, computation to finally decide if this is parallelizable or not. But many times, if one of the pieces of the puzzle cannot be proved, the decision is conservative. I cannot do anything for you. There is no opportunity. So we have created another tool that is called the analyzer that is gaining a lot of traction. We launched this 3 weeks ago, but essentially we are providing three command line tools, not graphical user interface, where you can have access to all the capabilities that you saw before. So the effects and the recommendations in the check, the opportunities in the loops, and the generation part in the database. So all of the capabilities from the UI are available from the command line. You can automate, from scripting, and run this not through one file. For big projects of hundreds of files, millions of lines of code. Okay? And you can use it not only in the coding parallelization stage, which is typically 50% of the effort, but also in the debugging stage, which is typically 30% of the effort. You have coded parallel code, and now you want to verify if it is correct. This is where the defects and recommendations come into play as a static database detection that is fast and can prove the existence of this for GPUs. No tool is covering that. Okay? So this is the other thing we are doing. So this is how the tool looks like. Typical command line interface with the typical options, with a listing of defects and recommendations, with all the information available publicly in the website. And here we tell you each of them for which languages we can detect issues in C, upcoming, Fortran, and C++. Okay? And this is essentially the typical output in the command line. The red exclamation mark translates in the command line into pointing to giving you a message, file, line number, column number, the message and the variable, and also something interesting for the technical depth, that is, how can I improve my code to make it better prepared before starting to parallelize it? Follow best practice recommendations of what experts do. As small as the lifetime of the objects, as small as the data scoping, even before starting to analyze opportunities. Okay? So this is about the recommendations, and defects is code that is already parallel that is incorrect. If you remove the minus grid here, for each of these items, you will find the details of the where is the problem, and how you make coverage. Okay? And we're evolving this very, very fast. So, to end, we have started an early access program. This tool will be commercial at some point, but it is completely free. And eventually, we'll also have probably one free version. The early access program, you can register for free, you can download the tool, Javier and me can provide you with the licenses. And this is it's taking a lot of attraction from centers like NERS, CAUS, because why? Because whenever someone has a new code and needs to get started with, where do they begin? Probably the code is not well prepared for parallelization. There is a lot of technical debt or things that can be improved. These are the recommendations. The other thing is the code was correct, but there are still hidden risk conditions. These are the defects. And this tool can guide you through the process of preparing the code before starting to discover opportunities and starting to decide how to prepare. Okay? So if you are interested or know of someone that is interested, please spread the word, give the link, you will be able to download for free, and we want to engage with the wider community. And this has been a lot of traction. For the first time, we have presented with the University of Aachen in Germany, above in the supercomputing. It was the second most competitive both program ever, and many interesting buffs were not approved. Ours was approved. Why? Because quality assurance and coding standards that help to apply best practice recommendations of the expert for development of parallel software is a very, very hot topic. It's a very, very hard problem in the HPC community. Codes evolve, pass through different hands, and in the end, nobody knows if the code is conformant to coding standards or not. Why? Because coding standards for parallel programming don't exist. Other industries like functional safety, we had a keynote this morning by Hugh Levels, or cybersecurity, there are very well established coding standards that provide the defects and recommendations that you need to be compliant with for the code to be released for healthcare, for automotive cars, for many industries. There is no such a thing in parallel programming. There are guides, tutorials, recommendations, but it is not formalized in the form of defects and recommendations. So for this, we have really great speakers that confirm that they will be with us. David Berkholm from Organizational Lab, Dick Plater from Jewish Supercomputing Center, Samuel Fekir from Saudi Arabia, CAUS Supercomputing Center. Also will be here from the Carnegie Mellon University and the Software Engineering Institute, Robert Schiella, the CTO behind one of the certification standards for cybersecurity. He will be here. And we're also looking for 2-3 more big names to be panelists and speakers in the world. So if you are interested in these things or you know someone that is interested, please go to the link, and if you can, you are going to attend supercomputing attendable, because we will try to build an early community of people interested in creating the first early versions of a future coding standard for Parallelization. That somehow writes down in a very clear manner the rules of what good HPC code means, and if we can check if the code, a code is compliant with this coding standard. We're starting this movement, so please spread the word and participate and collaborate with us, because it is really, really exciting, exciting thing. And that's it. That's what we wanted to tell you, just as a brief note, side note. So please, surveys, I need to ask you to fill them in and give them back to us.